Right, okay, question. There's no need to answer out loud, although don't mind if you do. Where were you at 11 o'clock or half 11, whatever it is now, on January the 14th, 2017? You probably don't know. I can kind of answer that question. I know one thing. You weren't here. You weren't here. You weren't sat in this room in Embrace Church Darlington. Because one of the remarkable things God did in 2017 was He birthed Embrace Church Darlington. One of the remarkable things. He put us together in His worldwide family, but in this local setting, and He called us Embrace. So what has 2018 got in store, I wonder? You know, where will we be on January the 14th, 2019? Wow. It's the first time I've used those words, 2019. Where will we be? I wonder, what's God going to do? But the fact we're here now was totally unexpected. Totally unexpected. Probably for all of us. Certainly was for me. So what's 2018 got in store? And you know, Joyce shared that word with me probably about 2 months ago now. And it just really spoke to me. And I felt it wasn't to be given on any particular Sunday other than this one. I felt this was the Sunday to give it. As we look ahead, the year ahead, what we feel God's going to be doing through this little part of His worldwide family that we call Embrace, I wanted Joyce to share that word. And for us to base our year on that word, I really did. I really felt it was a word for the year. And I'm just going to summarize it really quickly, what Joyce said. One, God builds His church. Fact. Two, we are all crucial. Fact. Three, pray to God and listen to what He says. Four, the hard bit, act on what He says. Be doers of God's word. And five, as we go into this year, we've got some thoughts and ideas and we feel God spoke, and I'm going to unpack some of that now. But as we go along the year, we will be corrected as we go. And God will add, and God will probably take some away, and God will do what He wants to do. And we want to follow God as He does what He wants to do. So I'm excited about this year. I'm excited. And listen, I just want to talk about Jesus. You might not be surprised at that. Jesus died on the cross and then He was resurrected, and He did that to make us an incredible offer. He made us an offer of abundant life, not an easy life, an abundant life, and then a guaranteed place in heaven if we just choose to accept Him for who He is and what He did and follow Him. An incredible offer. Okay? And I know many people in this room live in the abundance, live in the goodness of that abundant life, of that full life. They live in God's love. They live in God's peace. They live in God's joy. And God is a good influence in our lives if we follow Him. He's a good influence in our relationships, our jobs, our health, even our finances. They can go up and down, but He's a good influence in all of those things. And then we're guaranteed a place in a perfect heaven. And that was costly to God. He sent His only Son, Himself really, to die the most horrific and torturous death in our place. He did it for us. Now that's passion. That's passion. That was God's passion for us, for me and for you. That we can have a full life and then a guaranteed place in heaven. And I want to talk about our passion for Him. I want to talk about our passion for Him. And I read something on Facebook the other day, and it said, write your obituary and then live accordingly. And that really struck me. When I die, what is going to be written about Alan Fraser? I don't want it, the main thing to be he watched a lot of TV. I don't want that to be the main thing when I die. You know, he just slept in on a Sunday morning. He just, you know, I don't want things like that to be the main thing. And that really got to me. I thought, right, I'm going to write my obituary and then I'm going to live my life accordingly. Now, we know it's all in God's control, and that's where I go, but that really struck me. And he has great plans for us. God has great plans for us. But he has great plans for us to join him in doing. So, great plans for us personally, that he wants to do in our lives, but also he's got plans for us to do that will benefit and help other people. And Psalm 132 talks about passion, human passion for God. And it involves self-denial. You think, what is self-denial? Self-denial is doing something for God when you'd much rather be doing something for yourself. So, you know, I could just put my feet up and watch every episode of Only Fools and Horses again. And I love Only Fools and Horses, and I will watch them again. But I could just do that and things like that all the time. That's not really a passion for God. It's doing something for God when you'd much rather be doing something for yourself. But the beautiful thing is, when we do something for God, he blesses us, and we actually enjoy it more than the thing we would have done had we just picked our own selfish thing. He blesses us. There is more pleasure in doing something for God. Sometimes it can be really hard, but the pleasure is still more than we could give ourselves. God's passion was 100% for us. Our passion, Psalm 132 makes it very clear, involves self-denial, self-sacrifice, self-cost. And as we go through this talk, called the year ahead, commit to one, which will become clear as time goes on, it involves us joining with God. We were just praying before the service started, and God said this very clearly. It's not that we are working for God, but we are working with God. And that's a big difference. We are not employees who slavishly have to do our 9-to-5 for God. That's not it. We're not employees of God, but we are brothers and sisters in the family business. We are brothers and sisters in his family business. He wants to expand his church and expand his kingdom in Darlington and the nations in 2018. And we are caught up in that. It's not like, we've got to go and do some stuff for God. No, no, we're co-workers. We're his brothers and sisters in God's family business. So let's crack on. So, Embrace Church Darlington, this is our heart. This is our PowerPoint. This is our heart. To take the kingdom of God into Darlington, the region, the UK and the nations. And we want Embrace Church Darlington here to be a place where people, that's me and you, will encounter God and grow in their God-given gifts and abilities. That's our heart. And our vision, our mission, if you like, is to know, grow, go, which Joy talked about. We want people to know the good news. It's good news. Jesus is good news. So many people in the world don't even realize it's good news. We want people to know the good news of Jesus. We want people to then grow in their relationship with Jesus. And we then want to be people who go into the world with the good news of Jesus. That's us. That's who we are as a church. And God will envision us as we go along. And we'll sometimes get it wrong and he'll correct us. That's our heart. Why? Because it's God's heart. It's God's heart. Right from the start, we were based on Matthew 28 about going to the world. And Acts 2 about looking after each other. We want to grow the family. And we want to grow the people in the family. We want to grow the family, and we want to grow the people who are already in the family. And as well as the Bible, I'll just come back on that one, sorry. And there's some of the things that we currently do that enable people to know Jesus, that enable people who are going to grow in Jesus in ways in which we can go to people. And there's loads there, isn't there? So Sunday is an opportunity for us to grow in Jesus. Sunday is often like one big Bible study, isn't it? You know, someone will preach out of Hebrews or something. And as someone, whoever's preaches on that, we grow in that. We give it our full attention. That's why I've got books to help us. We can jot things down. We can, what's God saying? We can write down memorable things. We can grow, but there's lots of things on there. Some things crop up more than once, don't they? Like the breakfasts. We grow in God as we spend time together, as people talk about Him. And then yesterday, they had to have breakfast at the No Column, because yesterday we had people who don't know Him coming along to the men's breakfast, and maybe the ladies' breakfast too. I don't know, I wasn't at the ladies' one, but I was at the men's one, and there were people there who'd never made any commitment to Jesus. And that helped them to know a little bit more about Him. So there's lots of things up there that we can get involved in, that we do as a church, if you like. Okay, lots of things up there that enable us to know Jesus, if we don't already, to grow in God's good news, and to go. And we're going to continue with all of those things into the next year. We're going to continue with all of those things. The writing books is actually far too growing, isn't it? Just a book with a pen helps us to grow as we jot things down and bring them into our lives. And here's some prophetic words God's given us recently. And I'm going to read them from there. Embrace carries something unique in Darlington. This wasn't us saying this about ourselves. This was people, some of them not even from Darlington, who have spoken to us. Who've spoken to us about what they believe God is saying to us. That's what a prophetic word is. It's people speaking on behalf of God to people. So it's not their opinion. It's what they believe, they sense God is saying to someone. Prophetic words can come through just a sense. They can come through a dream, come through a picture that suddenly pops into your mind. And when you get one, you tend to know that could be God. And people, some people who we'd never met before until we spoke to them, had words for us. Embrace carries something unique in Darlington. We give life to other people. We're not about Embrace only. We give life to others, to other churches, to other Christians. We are a catalyst to others. So we don't need to do everything in Darlington, thank God. We don't need to do all God's work in Darlington, thank God for that. But that as a church, we will enable and equip and help other Christians and churches to carry out their role in Darlington. That's what God said to us, small as we are. And we already see evidence of that happening. We already see other churches starting to organise things on the back of what we've organised. Similar things. God said, the more we give away, the more God will give us. You've got to be a church that's generous. Why? Because it's good to be generous. But God said, and the blessings, actually, He'll give us more back. That's why we went into town one Saturday and just gave out balloons. Just gave out lollies, just gave out books about Jesus. We didn't really tell him about Embrace Church that much. That was a very minor part of the day. We were just generous to the people of Darlington. It cost the church money. But God said, do it. So we did it. He told us to love people of Darlington. Not as some great strategy to kind of woo them into our church, but actually just to love them. Love them for loving them's sake. That was part of the balloon thing. That's part of inviting people to breakfast and so on. We felt, particularly for a couple of months before Christmas, we were in a time of setting and creating culture and a period of setting foundations. And we will always create culture. We will always set foundations. But we felt that was a specific time for the number that we are, just to grow together. I do feel now we are in a time of upthrust. I do feel that time starts today. That we've had that period of consolidation, if you like, and now there's upthrust. There's upthrust coming. There's growth coming, numerical growth. I'm not ashamed or afraid to say that. I believe in that, that's coming. We need to be a church of visibility and accountability. We're not going to stay in this hall and be invisible to Darlington. We are going to go out there. We are already going out there. Going to the quiz last night was being visible. There's some more. Someone specifically gave us 2 Kings 3:9. which says this, basically, he put it in his own words. Keep asking for things that we haven't got. God can provide things from nowhere. Forget the budget, or how much money we have or haven't got. Forget, you know, human resources. If God wants to provide us with something miraculously, all of a sudden, he can and he will. And he has done. We don't always have to do things the way we've always done them or how we think they should be done. Be creative. God has asked us to take some godly risks. Some crazy risks. Someone actually said, it doesn't matter if you get them wrong. Who cares? Let's have some fun doing it. But, you know, if church is a little bit different one Sunday, that's great. We're going to do that sometimes. You know, we're not going to always do things according to the book that someone wrote. We're going to do it according to God's book, not man's book. Do everything with great joy. Let this place be a place of joy. Who cares if the words go wrong for the first two songs? Let's just be joyful. Let's enjoy God's presence. Be found in the marketplace, not in the temple. Well, actually, Jesus was found in both, wasn't he? But a very recognized prophetic person, actually, in the Salt and Light family of churches said to us, he believes we should be found in the marketplace, not in the temple. Do you know what? If our home one day is not to be in this lovely building, who cares? So what? You know, we don't have to be found in this beautiful historical church building. We're enjoying it whilst we are. But if that was to change one day, and this isn't, you know, this is an accorded message. Don't read into something I'm saying here. You know, I'm just saying, if that were to happen one day, who cares? It doesn't matter. And another one was about Noah's Ark. And at the moment, you know, we've got a couple of this type of person, a couple of that type of person, a couple of younger children, a couple of youths, a couple of whatever. And you can look at it sometimes and think, that's not a lot. That's not very big. But you know, the animals went into Noah's Ark two by two. But when they came out, they populated the world. They multiplied. And I believe in that. I believe that someone, this isn't our ideas and our opinions, these are words that people gave to us that they felt were from God, that this church would be like Noah's Ark. We're small in number now, but we will multiply and multiply. Now, it doesn't mean we're all going to be in one room all the time, anything like that. That's a different thing. So, I hope that all that made some sense. Let's have a look at what next. These are some things I believe we are entering into in 2018. Trustees, etc. We are going to be sharpening up and developing our legal structures. Why? Because we haven't got any right now. It's the honest truth. We've got very few. Right? But we're going to be sharpening up just who we are legally in our status and what we need to have to accompany that. And the trustees basically look after legal and financial. Make sure we're not doing anything wrong. Make sure Paul and Alan aren't doing anything immoral. That's basically what the trustees do. And if you, even now, are thinking, maybe I could be a trustee of this church, please come and tell us. Please come and tell us. It's a spiritual thing. It's legal. It's paperwork. I would find that a bit boring. But it's a spiritual thing. And right now, God might just be saying, you could be a trustee. And even if he's not, I would say consider it. We're going to be starting something called Matthew 18:20 groups. What is Matthew 18:20 groups? Some of you are definitely trying to think, what does it say in Matthew 18, verse 20? And do you know what? Right now, I'm not going to tell you. So there's your challenge for today. Go home, look up, not yet, look up Matthew 18:20, see what it says. But we recognize as a church that we want to go deeper in our relationships with each other. It's part of the grow thing, okay? We want to grow in God and in each other. And we're going to be having Matthew 18 to 20 groups. It's around the word accountability. Now, they're not compulsory. They're for those people who want to sign up to them. But we will give you more information on those in due course. Over the next few weeks, we'll be coming to you and telling you about those groups. But that's going to be something new for us to grow further in God this year. And then we're thinking, and what about going? Where's God taking us this year beyond this building? We're not going to be stuck in a building. Where's he taking us? I know Tony had something of a half a skirm pack. Why? Doesn't know. She just senses that God said. That's enough, isn't it? If God said, we explore that. Does it mean this year? I don't know. Joyce talked about putting jigsaw pieces in. And then you think, oh, it doesn't quite fit. I'll put that over there and come back to that later on. Is that this year? Don't know. But we're going to be exploring that. God spoke to me about the Methodist building in Northlands. I don't know if you know it, but there's a fantastic building up North Road, opposite Morrison's, a bit further up. And it doesn't have a congregation. Okay, they do some things there, but basically it doesn't have a congregation. And I kept trying to put that down out of my mind, because I've known about this for about four months. And God just keeps bringing it back to my mind. And I'm just wondering, God, what are you saying about us and Northlands in 2018? And I'm looking for God to join those dots. You know, it might not be us in Northlands in 2018. It might not be. But God just seems to have dropped it into my mind. And we're going to explore that pop-up church. We're going to go to other places. We don't know where yet. We don't know when yet. But we believe we will do that. We're going to welcome people from other areas of town to come and see us, to see what we are. But we're not going to welcome them here initially. We're going to go to them. We're just going to see where that might go. Obviously, a big part of that is continuing what we're already doing in the east end of town, around the Wheatsheaf area. That is a big priority for us. We're already making great strides in that area. God has opened up opportunities. And you know, it's not hard work. It's going to a quiz and having fun. I love it. And sometimes conversations open up about Jesus. It's great. We want to see a children's, youth and student ministry develop this year. We believe God's put that in our heart. We want to serve Darlington in every way we can. One way we do that already is we give 10% of all our income away. And if I'm right, Paul, we've got £600 from last year to give to Darlington Town Mission. Is that right? £600 is the final figure, is it? So we will give 10% to another charity this year. If you've, or you know, good cause. If you feel you've got a good cause or charity, a local one that we would like to give our money to this year, just let one of us know. I've got a few ideas whirring around in my head as well. But let us know and we can maybe look at that. And we want to do something for the nations. We're not just a Darlington church. I was so thrilled when Alan got up to pray for Christians in China. We'll never meet them till we get to heaven. But it's right that we pray for them, and actually they pray for us. And I just want to add to that, right now we are in the process of becoming an official church for Open Doors, which isn't a massive commitment, but it is a commitment. And Open Doors, if you were here before Christmas when I spoke on the part from Matthew, blessed are the persecuted. We talked about the persecuted church in the world a little bit. We've made a commitment to become a church as an official Open Doors church that will be involved with Christians around the world. And prayer is priority. I want to add that right now. Above all of this, over all of this, prayer is priority. I want you to get that deep inside you for this year. Prayer is priority. It's easy to remember. Prayer is priority. And with that in mind, one thing we've done is, obviously we're now meeting every Sunday night to pray together for an hour. Come along if you can. It's great. Even if that involves some self-denial that we talked about, some self-sacrifice, come along, it's great. You'll be glad you did it. It's better than the thing you've sacrificed for. Well, there's another thing we've done with that is, it happened this morning with Alan being available to pray with, is we're going to make that a thing every Sunday, that it won't always be Alan, but he's going to pretty much head that up. Is we will be available to, people will be available to be prayed with, prayed for, struggling with that, throughout the service. Prayer is priority for the people of God. Let's keep it priority. Will that just flick forward one, Paul? Right, but they're not cool.
up one by one?
No, it doesn't matter, go on. So, here's the commit to one bit. I'm coming to a close. Commit to one. Here are some ways in which you can show passion for God. Now, don't mishear that. I know there are so many people who do so many things that demonstrate their passion for God already. So this isn't like a rebuke. Far from it. Here are just some examples of things we can do in 2018, and I've called it Commit to One. Okay, and I'll just go through them very quickly. The first one is the thing that becomes a butterfly. What's that called again? Caterpillar. So it's going from caterpillar to butterfly. And I'm talking about personal growth. I'm talking about your own growth in God. Out of the no-grow God, this is the grow bit. Commit to one more thing that you already do. Commit to one more if you can. So some of you I know have signed up for the Bible in a year. I'm having great fun with that. I'm loving it. I love it in the morning. Often we do it together. We put Nicky Gumbel on volume, you know, on loud, and we listen along to Nicky Gumbel, and then Pippa adds for like about 8 seconds. And we listen to that, and it's just great. It sets up our day. So what could you do to develop that personal growth? Maybe you could read the Bible a little more. Maybe you could pray a little more. Maybe you could just read some books around that, some study books a little more. Whatever it is, you feel, I could just do that. I could commit to one thing to develop my own growth this year. You know, be responsible for your own growth. You know, be responsible for feeding yourself good stuff. Commit to whatever you're doing now or not doing. If you can, commit to one thing more. Second thing is that we just want to say thank you. And first of all, listen, so many people in this church serve brilliantly, not just here on Sunday morning, but in other ways throughout the week. And we just want to say thank you for that. Actually, on behalf of God, I feel that. Thank you. Just thank you for the service people give this church. It's incredible. You know, sometimes at 9:30, I just look around and there's like a buzz of activity. And I'm just sort of sat with a cup of tea at that point, just watching all these people doing all these different jobs. And I'm thinking, wow, it just warms my heart. So thank you. But if you can commit to one thing or one more thing, to serve this church, then that'd be much appreciated. And you might be at max right now, and that's okay. If you're at max right now, that's okay. Remember, this isn't a rebuke thing. But if you can think, actually, that is something I can do that I'm not doing, and I can, commit to that one. Commit to that one thing. Then the middle one, the dreaded jar of money. I'm going to talk finances. You know, we have costs. I'm just getting real here. We have costs. We pay into the building, and I'm a cost, and equipment is a cost. You know, we committed to some certain things that cost. Now, I'm not going to talk about percentages and things particularly. If you give nothing to Embrace right now, I wouldn't know if you do or don't. And do you know what? In one sense, I'm not particularly bothered. But perhaps you could commit to £1 then. If you don't give anything, perhaps you could commit to £1 a week. Commit to one. Commit to one. Just to help with the cost. And it's sowing into God's kingdom. It's a sacrifice, isn't it, that we talk about. Or maybe you are someone who, you know, you've read the Old Testament, you think, right, they gave 10%. The New Testament says just give a portion. But I like that guideline of 10%, and we've taught on that, and it's a good thing. Maybe you can give 10% and £1. Yeah. Whatever it might be. You know, I give 10% of what I get in. Now, what I get in now is a lot less than what I got in a year ago. So financially, that's changed a lot for me. But I still try to give 10% of what I get in now. And what I'm going to do in this area is I'm just going to round it up. So if I get 56, I'm going to round up to 60. If I'm to give 71, I round up to 80. I'm just going to round it up to nearest 10. That's my commitment to one area. The other one is Darlington. I've got a picture of Darlington. If you can. This is just an if you can. No one's going to be checking. Fine. If you can, commit to one area where you can give to Darlington. I don't mean financially necessarily, but you know, there are things where we can give to Darlington. We can give 1 hour maybe. Commit to 1 hour to give to Darlington. Okay, it could be volunteering in a charity shop. Ruth's parents run the Max Club, which is in this building, not this hall, but in this building. And it's just helping people who need a bit of help sometimes, befriending people. And I love it. And actually, I've benefited the most from it. I've made loads of new friends. I think it's set up for me. I've made loads of new friends going there. I love it. I go once a fortnight for 2 hours. It's not a great cost, but I love it. I love it. Whatever it is you could do, if you can give 1 hour, and it's amazing what God does in those things. How is that expanding the kingdom? I've hardly talked about Jesus yet, and I've been going since September. But it is. It's expanding God's kingdom. It's showing the people of Darlington God's love. And opportunities for conversations have begun to happen. It wasn't quick. It wasn't the first night. But just last Monday, I was chapter member of staff. And she said, "What do you do?" And I said, "Well, I do two things. I teach children and I'm part of the church." And she was like, "Oh." And we were off. We were up and running. We had a conversation. Where's that going yet? Don't know. Commit to one thing if you can. And then we got the finger. It's the right finger, don't worry about it, it's a good finger. Commit to one person. So commit to yourself, to your own growth, commit to the church, commit financially, commit to out there, and now commit to one person. Let me tell you how this works. Alan and Sue committed to one, more than one actually, committed to people where they live, friends. Some of them, I'm sure they don't mind saying, are here now because of their commitment to them. They brought God into that. Obviously, at some point that happens, but they committed to them. That's growing God's kingdom over many days, weeks, months, and years. Let me tell you another one. Paul Saxton invites lots of people to men's breakfast. And like when I invite lots of people to Alpha, the truth is, Paul, a lot of them don't come today. A lot of them don't come. Who cares? Yesterday, someone who doesn't know Jesus at all came to the men's breakfast. So now he commits to that one. There's a follow-up conversation that we had there. There's things to do there. Commit to one. Let me give you another example. Tony commits to one. Pointing at Colin. She commits to one. One. He comes along. He hears what Jesus did. He chooses to follow him. He commits to two. They're here today. Do you see? You see? One commits to one. Commits to two. And so it goes on. That's committing to one. Make a friend who's not a Christian. It's hard that, isn't it? It's hard sometimes that, because we're so, you know, and it's right to commit to each other. We need to do that. Gosh, don't ever stop meeting together. That's in Hebrews, I mean, isn't it? It's in the Bible, anyway. Keep meeting, right? But commit to one. And sometimes you have to commit to a lot. You've just got to throw some seeds out and see which one bites, if you like. See which one person bites onto what you've thrown out. Commit to that one. We can do that. Commit to one person this year. When I was at the Counts by Candlelight, I counted, I think, there was 57 people. That wasn't a magic wand, right? That 57 turned up. That was you inviting people. God gave us a glimpse of what can be done. Some of them might have been Christian, some of them might not have been. Some of them probably can't come again because they live further afield, whatever. But you get an idea of the picture of what can be done. There are people out there who do not know God's love, who do not know what Jesus did for them, who he is. Let's commit to one. And I'm just going to say this. Many years ago, Tony and I were unable to commit to just about any of those things. Right? We were Christians, we were in a church, and we could hardly do any of them. Because at that point, we had to commit to one another. My one and my everything I was committing to was Tony. and the kids. And Tony's one, and everything she was committed to was me and the kids. But we couldn't get to meetings. We couldn't, you know, we wanted to. We're like, oh, we can't get to that Lincoln meeting again. We wanted to get to prayer groups, but we couldn't. We wanted to get to life group, but we couldn't. We just couldn't. I'm not going to go into the reasons, but we just couldn't. But it was all right. It was all right because that season of our lives, we had to just commit to each other. And it was for years. Years. Right? For years we didn't get to things. And it's all right. In fact, it's better than all right because that's exactly what we were meant to be doing. God had said that my role at that point was to commit to Tony. Almost only to Tony. Tony's role was to commit to me, almost only to me. We had very little time for anything else. So I understand that there are circumstances and seasons in life when all I've just said might not apply. I get that. I'm not talking about that. If you're doing things at the expense of things God has said you should do, you've got that wrong. We were meant to commit to each other and very little else at that point. And that's what we did. Different season now, we can commit to other things. We still commit to each other, obviously, but not only each other now. So don't feel that any difficulty, any condemnation, or anything that's been said. But sometimes I know in my heart there's a choice. Do I watch Let Another Only Fools and Horses, which I love, or do I do one of those things? And sometimes I'll probably choose the wrong one. Being honest, but my heart is to choose the right one. And when we do these kind of things this year, just one more screen poll please, everyone is a winner, because Psalm 132, which I started with, and I realize I've been quite lengthy today, but I felt I needed to do this today. But Psalm 132 starts by talking about self-denial, giving up the things you really want to do to do what God wants you to do. But as I said, he did promise us blessings. And these are the blessings that are mentioned at the end of Psalm 132. And then, Tony, are you going to sing again after that, are you?
What?
You're going to sing after this, are you? I'll be 1 minute. As we self-deny ourselves, as we put aside our selfish motives, and I'm the worst for it, I can't bother, I just want to play our football on the computer or whatever, I'm the worst for it. But as we set aside those things for God, for his kingdom, for his church, for Darlington, for your neighbour, and biblically everyone you meet is your neighbour, you will be blessed and they will be blessed beyond how you bless yourselves with our own motives. So as you give to others, so God gives more to you. And Psalm 132 at the end promises this. As you self-deny, it promises the following blessings. Provision for you. That doesn't mean you win the lottery. I'm not against that. Remember, I'm your friend if you do. But provision for you. You will see salvation in others. What a thrill that is. You know, it warms my heart to see Colin here now. A changed man. Changed life. A man of God. And like me, he once wasn't. It warms my heart to see salvation of us. And he will give you, as you self-deny, there's no self-denial in it, because he will give you provision, joy, strength, direction, and the thing Mick Jagger needed but couldn't find, satisfaction. That's what Psalm 132 promises. And I can't think of anything else I need or want. So let's be passionate for God in 2018.